I'm wearing my favourite rock and roll scarf because we're sticking with the music theme for this Fixer Diary. Well, dates back to 2005. In fact, we should go back a little bit further to around about the mid-90s, which is when Travis were starting out. Now, I don't know about you, but I love discovering new bands. And at the time, Travis were starting out and they were getting a little bit of exposure. And being in the media, I did what I could to help elevate them and get them as much exposure as we could. But it got to a point where I couldn't get the band, I couldn't get Travis on any of my shows. So I sent their manager, Ian, an email one day. In fact, I must have been having a bad day that day because I guess I had no filter and I just fired off this email, which I don't remember the exact details of it, but it went along the lines of, if this band aren't careful, the people that put them there, who they're ignoring, are going to end up turning against them, and in fact, they might end up getting a bad reputation in Scotland. So the next day, I get into my office and I fire up my computer, and there's an email from Ian. And his reply went along the lines of, the sort of gist of the email was, in all the 12 years in music management, managing bands like the Brand New Heavies and Craig David, I've never had anyone speak to me like this. Well, that email that I sent Ian initiated what would become a good business friendship and a mutual respect, and for years to go after that. And every time we worked together on any project or any of his artists played any of the shows or the events that I was involved in, Ian always made sure we got what we wanted. Anyhow, fast forward to 2005, and Ian called me up and says, "Hey, I'm coming to Glasgow with this new band I'm managing. Would love your take on them. Do you want to come and join me?" And I'm like, "Yeah, we'll look forward to it. Where are they playing?" He's like, "Well, we're playing King Tut's." Now, if you know King Tut's Wawa Hut in Glasgow, you will know that it is the infamous venue where Oasis were discovered by their manager, Alan McGee. It's just an amazing venue. I mean, I love it. I've saw so many bands there before they became really big. People like Coldplay, Muse, Beck, No Doubt. Everyone's played King Tut's. It's small, intimate, sweaty, great, great place. In fact, saying this out loud, I can't imagine being in a venue like that anymore, but hopefully one day. So we're in there and I was impressed how busy it was. I mean, really good turnout for this band. And I'm like, huh, that's kind of promising. And right before they were about to come on stage, I said to Ian, "What's the name of the band again?" And he turns to me and he says, "Arctic Monkeys." Well, they came on stage, and what blew me away initially was the fact that this band, Arctic Monkeys, had never released a single, but every single person in King Tut's knew every single word to their songs. And they might have been scrappy teenagers, but those boys had some serious stage presence. Alex Turner was fantastic, and the band were just super tight. So of course, immediately I was like, oh, love these guys. I knew I was seeing something really special. And of course I'd said to Ian, yes, anytime they're doing anything, I want to be involved. And it was good fun, you know. Over the next few years, we worked together. I remember a funny memory watching Arctic Monkeys backstage at Tina Park in 2006. That year, the World Cup was on, and a lot of the festivals would put on the games in the artist area and the VIP. And Arctic Monkeys were running around with the guys from Kasabian, and they're all drinking and jumping on tables and being typical young lads. The following year, in 2007, I moved to America, but I reunited with Ian and the Arctic Monkeys at Coachella in 2007. And we hung out backstage, and you know, they're still young, they were still in their early 20s, still had a long way to go, I guess. And you know, I've lost touch with them over the years, but it's been really fun to watch them develop over the past, what, 13 years or so, and evolve into handsome, young, refined men. And their music's obviously just got better and better. But I'll leave you with this one thing that always sticks in my mind, and I remember it at the time because I was involved with them. But back in around about 2006, when Arctic Monkeys were just really starting to blow up, Noel Gallagher and Morrissey both took a pop at Arctic Monkeys. Like, you know, they'll never be any good. Everything's happening too quick for them. It'll never last. Songwriting, this and, you know, all these different artistic things they said. But hey, who's laughing now?